Hey everybody, it's Mark Oakley here with another episode of From the Drawing Board, from the actual drawing board. And it's been a long time since I've done a video with you guys, and I thought it was high time to get back into it. It's been a long time. There's a lot of things been going on in my life recently. I moved recently, so I'm in a new studio space. It's not very well decorated. I got some pretty basic backgrounds going on, but I've been trying to make comics and trying to sort of get to, hang on, what's going on here? I need some inks that work. What? Oh, there we go. Everything's a little out of whack, as you can see. So yeah, I moved into a new place, and this was as a result of meeting my future wife. I'm getting married. That was another big thing that that came down from the sky and made life very complicated in a very good way. My living circumstances improved greatly. I was living in this... Oh, man, it was like... Okay, back up, little story here. So I was... living with this dude who was actually the, you know, Ariel's dad, so this good friend of mine who was the inspiration for the Stardrop character, old friend, very, very good person, and so I became sort of friends with the family, and at one point her father, who's single now, was, you know, big into... Well, he was in a new part of his life, too. He's widowed, and he... just likes to travel the world. That's his jam. You know, he wants to spend 8 months of the year just going to exotic locations and just backpacking around. And he's pretty spry for all that. And he wanted me to wanted someone to sort of house sit while he was away, just sort of keep the home fires burning. It's kind of important to do that in old houses. Houses need life in them, otherwise they just get reclaimed by the earth. They mold and drips, and it doesn't take very long for the earth to just sort of swallow architecture. And so you need someone living in a space to keep it alive. And he asked me. I said, yeah, sure, I'd love to do that. So I was living with him, and then COVID hit, and so I was like, oh geez. So he couldn't travel, and so it's just these two guys in a house, and we got along relatively well, but we had quite different personalities. And after a certain point, after a couple of years, he said, it's time for you to move on. So yeah, I could feel that coming. So I packed up everything and started looking for a place. And in the interim, because the place I was in previous to that was jumping in, you know, rent value or market value. When I got it, it was like, I think I was spending like, you know, 480 or 500 bucks a month. It was incredibly reasonable for this little carriage house, sort of. Had two floors, spiral staircase, really, really neat. And that was like 2010-ish. So quite a while ago. I spent like 5-6 years there. And the guy who owned the place, who really, really believed in, you know, when I met him, he said, you know, I believe that it is a terrible sin for people to be gouged on rent. And so he gave me a great deal. He had four tenants in there, and they all got a great deal. And he was saying, like, look, even just charging less than market value, I'm covering the mortgage easily, repairs. I'm making a profit on this place. It's a good deal. So like, okay, that's wonderful. But he was an older gentleman. He was, God, he must've been in his early 80s by the time he said he got out of that game. He told me, yeah, I'm selling the place. So just, you know, stay abreast of that piece of news. I was like, okay. And it was bought by a younger couple out of Ontario, and they were looking to invest in a piece of property. And I don't know if they're thinking B&Bs or whatever, but, you know, you knew the news was in the wind. It was going, the rent was going to go up, and, but you're sort of grandfathered in. So they pulled that sort of, it's a little shady. Like when I met them, I was like, oh, hey, you're the new, you know, landlord and lady. This is wonderful. I really enjoy living here. Hope we can work well together. They couldn't make eye contact with me, man. They couldn't make eye contact with me, and I knew it was coming. So there's this little loophole in rent law in Nova Scotia, where, well, you can't evict someone just to jack the rent up. And you, there's sort of a cap on how much you could push the rent up. So what they do is they say, well, we're going to renovate. We're going to put in new walls and redo the roof or whatever. They actually did a fair bit to the place. If you're renovating, then you can legally evict people. Say, hey, we're renovating, out you go. And so I was like, oh, geez. And it was really funny. I was talking to the property manager, because they hired a property manager to do this. And he was working with a bunch of different properties. And he told me what was going on. I said, well, I'll look around. I'll see if I can find somewhere to stay in the interim. It's a bit of a short notice. Got 30 days. I'll start hunting around and see what comes up. And he goes, okay, cool. And I didn't hear back from him. Construction started on the building. And they're, working on one of the apartments below me. And I said, oh, okay, I guess someone's going to tell me what's going on at some point. And I'm lying in bed, and the wall beside my bed cracks open. And there's like some serious, on the outside, they were taking the outside off to do insulation stuff. They didn't come into my unit, but it was just like, I don't know if they know I'm here. It sounds like there's like the whole building shaking. So I come down, I'm like, hey, what's going on? And there's a construction dude goes, there's someone in here. There's a guy in this building, is not empty. I was like, well, no one told me. So I was talking to the property. He said, you told me that you found a place. I said, no, I said I was looking, and we had, it doesn't matter. I got nowhere to live, and I haven't found out. I mean, geez, I guess it was incumbent on me to find somewhere. But oh no, I remember he said he was going to look around and see if he had an empty property that it could move me into. So I was sort of waiting on that. And he thought that I'd already found a place. So it was just, I just got lost between the cracks. And I almost really did get lost between the cracks. Like, they had that whole wall out the next day. So it was just like big teardown. Anyway, so he's just like, so one of the other properties actually had a unit. And he took me up there and said, yeah, the previous tenants just moved out. They were students. I'll just charge you what you're currently paying. But it's temporary. You can't live there forever. So you got another 60 days or whatever. So I hastily moved all my, where did I put everything? Maybe I left it stored in the place. I think in my old apartment, I just put plastic over everything. I could move that out there. It was sort of a very janky sort of last second kind of arrangement. So I was living with a laptop and a bag of clothes and like a rollout inflatable mattress in this other place. And I spent a weird summer there. And my plan at the time was I'll find somewhere, but it was very hard to find properties that were affordable in Nova Scotia. Oh yeah, the rent on that place, I asked, well, what is it going up to? 1600. So from 500 to 1600. I was like, holy smokes, I can't. That's madness, I'm not doing that. So I was looking around everywhere in Canada was very, very expensive. It's just like, there's a serious flaw in our political, economic sort of growth of this empire, or involving inflation and stuff, where it just seems that rents just go up and up and up. It doesn't go down anywhere. I wasn't seeing any evidence of like market saturation of too many houses and rents dropping as market forces. I guess it would have to happen at some point, but I just haven't seen it. And it seems to be a problem everywhere. I'm not really sure. There's a lot that can be said about that. But I did notice that there was one province that did have much cheaper rents, and it was Quebec. And I think it was because it's harder to work in, it's a smaller population that has different growth dynamics, because it's largely French. And my French is like high school bad French. I can't speak it. And a lot of people don't want to move there. And there's a lot of sort of exclusionary social forces that are still in effect. Like if you're an Anglo, it's hard to get a job, there's discriminatory practices. Apparently I was talking to a few people who'd worked and said, yeah, they'll love you, but they will always preferentially hire French speaking people. I was like, oh, okay. And my French is crap anyway. So, well, I guess if I'm working in comics and I'm not really locked to a specific location, maybe I can make that work. Yeah, I can make that work. And heck, I'll learn French. It's going to be great. So I rented a car and drove across the country to Quebec for a couple of weeks just to look around and find somewhere to live, and wound up in Old Quebec. And I thought I was going to move out there. Things are much more affordable. Like, Old Quebec is this like walled city, the only one in North America. It's gorgeous. It looks like, this is like Thieves and Kings land, man. This is great. I want to live here. and I found a bachelor place that was like, I couldn't, it was like $400 or $500 for this beautiful, you know, little room in a city that's made of stone. I was like, oh, this is wonderful. And I met a couple guys when I was out there. This one really neat dude who was sort of like the French Canadian version of a guy that I was good friends with in Wolfville. I find people tend to hold offices, not there's a lot of repeating faces that show up. It's like, oh, it's you again, except you're a different person, but you have all the same mannerisms, and it's like you pick up the conversation where he left off because he's finding the same experience. Yeah, you remind me of a guy that I was, and so I was all excited about moving to Quebec, and so that was going to happen. I felt, oh, this, my life is going to explode and change, new people, I'm going to leave behind a lot of dear friends, and do I really want to do this? Which at which point Ariel's dad was like, here's an offer that's an unbelievably good one. It was like, I think it was paying like $300 a month. I was like, that's almost free. And with the understanding that I'm house sitting. So it was a really, it was a family friend of a family kind of a deal. And I was like, oh geez, I feel like I'm being a little bit of a coward though. Like there's this whole adventure with a lot of variables and a lot of new possibilities that would have taken me to a, you know, a big walled city in Quebec, and I feel like that would be scary and probably full of all kinds of reward. I should really do that, but I'm a little scared. And you know what was the deciding point? And in old Quebec, there's very, very thin little narrow streets, like from any kind of medieval city. And I was worried, like, how am I gonna, where am I gonna park the truck, the moving truck, to move stuff into an apartment? Plus, I haven't been cleared for an apartment. Just because they're available doesn't mean they're gonna give it to me. So I'd have to get there, find somewhere to crash. This guy said he would put me up for a little while, and that was great. Or he could arrange something. I wasn't super concerned about that, but it was like ha blocking traffic for a whole day while you unload a truck in a little city. So that, and that street's vital. How do you? And just those little logistics were really concerning to me, and I was like, I don't want to have to deal with that. I'm staying in Nova Scotia. I'm taking this $300 a month deal, so ended up living with Gary, and so that's how that shifted. And that was actually pretty good. It wasn't a bad place to be during COVID, but anyway, Gary and I, he's a decent fellow, but we didn't quite, we were annoying each other. And he said, Mark, you're out of here. And he's one of these very, very passive kind of guys. So stress will build and he won't say a thing. You have to sort of like, what did he mean by that? What is he? For instance, and these aren't knocks against the guy at all. It's just the differences in character. He really believed in, you know, saving money to the point where he would have one light on in the entire house. Everything's off. And he would sit under in this one chair and read under this one light, and that's it. Nothing else is on, and all the entire house is this big, gloomy, dark place. And I'm like, oh, well, can I turn on a light? And if I, because he felt like, you know, he wanted to spend no more than $10 a day. That would include electricity, fuel, heating, food, just all his basic needs. If he could live $10 a day or less, he was very, very happy. And so I'd be going, well, my drafting board is electric now, and I have it on and these lights are on, and is it okay if we, you know, but I always felt like really sort of, he never said anything, never complained, but you just sort of like in your guessing, like you're probably making it worse in your own mind than it actually is. But there's this weird little stress. I'm like, you know, and eventually, I think whatever stresses come with living with Mark Oakley, and maybe there's a few, I can be quite a big energy, and you know, people seem to like me when they meet me, but after a length of time, unless you can sort of m match my sort of energy level, it can become a little difficult. And I understand it's extroversion versus introversion. This guy was such an introvert, so he'd had enough of me, and to the point where it's like, you're leaving like now, like yesterday. I was like, oh no. And I thought I had a bit of time to work. Is no, end of the month, you're gone. I was like, holy shit, okay, I can respect that. Fine, I've had a great deal. It was a real gift having that very low rent. When I had some other income, I was able to save up and buy a car. That was great. Needed that, so it was very, very positive in many ways. And it was time to go, you know. Although one of the great things about that whole arrangement was, Ariel would bring her kids over to visit their grandfather, and so her boys and I get along really, really well. Like, I've been there every step of the way through their lives. Like, I held them as newborns, and my hair went curly. It was weird. I think that's something that happens, like some kind of pheromonal thing kicks in. But so I just felt like I protect these kids with my life. It was just, it's wonderful to be an Uncle Mark. And they would visit 2-3 times a week. And I don't know. Their granddad was sort of, I think they have a reasonably good relationship now, but for some reason we just jived. We'd run around in the backyard, play all these games. It was really, really special. And so that was a wonderful part of that that experience. Anyway, so I'm out again. So it had been a while since I'd visited the whole expense of living expenses and rent in Nova Scotia. It had only gotten worse in the years between. And so now I'm back to, I can't afford anywhere. Everything's so incredibly expensive. What am I going to do? And not only that, during COVID, I don't know if you guys remember, but for some reason, Nova Scotia was one of the few places for a long time that had no cases of COVID. We're safe, you know, everything's bubbled down, no one's in, no one's out, and there's no cases of COVID reported. This is fabulous. It's a safe place to be. And some genius in government said, well, we can advertise this, you know, let's, so they're actually, like, apparently, I haven't seen them, but people reported billboard ads in Ontario, so along the roads, come to Nova Scotia, there's no COVID, it's cheap, it's a wonderful place to live, bring your Ontario money to our little province. And so people did. And so suddenly all these properties are getting bought up, and a lot of sort of international immigration, like other Canadians coming here. And so now there's a housing crisis. I think everybody in Nova Scotia, this is no joke, knows someone who's living in the woods or is homeless. There was a guy that I met through friends, and he's a writer, and he was just camping. That's how he spent a year. He was camping. So I meet him at Tim Hortons, whatever. He would use his computer, and we had these wonderful chats. Really smart guy. And I was like, well, what have you done? It's too damn expensive. I'm living in a tent. Like, that's the state of things. You know, you meet people who, you know, you visit their apartment, and I think $1,600, and he's got four roommates kind of thing, and they're all jammed in this little tiny place, and they can just barely scrape by because work is hard to come. There's a lot of job openings. Like, there's every fast food place is hiring, like Tim Hortons, or maybe it was Subway. One of them, Mickey D's, I can't remember, but right on their bags on the, you know, you get a hamburger and they put on the bags is, we're hiring. Like, they printed it on their packaging material. So it's like that, you know, not just an ad in the window, it's on the packaging material itself. So everyone's got an ad, we're hiring. Is that, I don't know how much time it takes to go through an order of brown paper bags that hold your hamburgers, but they clearly felt that it was a big enough step required to, we're going to be hiring for a long time. Let's just print it on our packaging. But no one wants those jobs because just driving to a job site with gas being expensive, you know, it's like it's too expensive to live to hold a job down. That's what some people are finding. It's tough. Anyway, so I'm in this situation and I'm looking for a place to live, and I'm stuck. There's nothing available. And the couple things that are just way out of my price range, and you're just desperate. Came across this one thing, and the reason it was available, it was a relatively new building, like 8 or 10 years old or whatever, and not whatever comments about the architecture, but it was a 50 plus building. So a lot of the people who are in the job hunting market were, you know, you can't come in, you got to be older than 50. And I was like, oh my God, I just turned 50, you know, like that month. You know, like I was like, I just turned 50. So like, oh my God, you're allowed in. It's great. So I was like, now the youngest guy in like a retirement building. That felt weird. I think all by myself, I brought the age curve down. 50 is pretty old, but there were people there who were very, very old. And it's a little late. It's kind of take that one on the chin. You're like, Like when I met my fiance, you know, her friends would joke, he lives in an old folks home. Oh God. Oh dear. Anyway, so I moved into there, and for a couple of years it was wonderful. And the thing that was neat, it was right across the way from my friend's restaurant, who and she lived and worked on the property. And so Ariel and I can zip across, like it's a 30-second walk to get a coffee and hang out. And in that same building, I put a YouTube studio. I took some of that cash that I'd saved up and bought a bunch of cameras and mics and whatnot. And we had this great little life for a couple of years. And then things got a little comfortable. Like it's, I think you need boundaries to push against, new projects to approach. I found I was living alone is really, really wonderful, but you're not challenged, and you're not you begin to, I don't know, ferment, no, ferment. You start to rot around the edges. You start growing mold on your body, you know, like not like figuratively. And it was funny, like after I started dating Creed, that's her name, within a month, 2 months, everyone's saying, "Oh my God, you look so much younger. You still look so much happier." And I was like, "Yeah, I feel like I was a little bit depressed during that period." And everyone goes, "Oh, you were depressed." And I was like, "I didn't notice it. I felt pretty good. I was just sort of, it was a low point with a lot of good bits of life going on. But yeah, I felt like I was sort of sinking, and now everything's turned around." And we moved out of that spot because it's rent, like rent control was ending, and we were just and also she's well under 50, and they were like the neighbors, like who's got a girl over, what's going on? And we made a lot of friends there. It was great, but it was also like they're gonna kick me out of here, you know. And she was leaving a messed up rental situation at her time, and was also in that market. And we just ended up, it was very, very natural, we just ended up living together. And so we got to find a place together. Plus, she comes with a dog. And there are no dogs in that building, or we could sneak it past, but Moo, that's our husky, very high energy animal, not suitable for apartment buildings. And so this place came up. Creed had some friends who were opening or had just opened a big business, and they had a piece of property with an in-law suite on it, and she made friends with them. And everything fit together nicely. I feel like I've heard this before and I believe it, but it's really neat to see it play out in real life. When you're on the right path, things just seem to naturally fall into place. And that has been my experience. And the one thing that can prevent that from happening, and it goes to show the truth of another saying that I really like, and it's possibilities end where fear begins. And when I started dating Creed, I was like, "Oh, do it, you know, I've got her number." And I asked her for, why did I ask her for her number? What was I thinking? Geez, do I call her? You gotta call her. You can't just ask a girl for her number and then never call her. That's mean. But do I do, what do I do? What do I do? You know, and I was really nervous about it because I've been through a bunch of relationships, and there was good, there's bad, but I always found it little heartbreaky and too difficult to sort of maintain. And I was like, oh, am I doing this again? Oh, geez, I'm happy. Am I happy on my own? I'm not sure. Just call her. You know, it's probably not going to turn into anything. She just seems really, really cool, and we can sit down, we can have coffee. That'll be great. And very quickly it went beyond that. But that was a fear hump that I had to get over. Moving was another fear hump. I was like, but I'm right near my friend, and I'm right in this nice situation, and it's hard to get a place. And why would I want to, you know, do I want to move into, I'm comfortable, and change is difficult. But I made that call. I knew that was the right thing to do. And so I got over another fear hump, and things have just gotten better and better and better. Because it's like, you look at a choice that comes up, and you're like, I know this would be healthy, but then you've got this little list of, but what if this happens? What if this goes wrong? I'll be uncomfortable to make that change. It's scary. What if I don't want to. And that's your list of cons versus the pros. But you can tell if it's the right thing to do if, when you look beyond that, you just know, I know. That's what I know. I'd regret it if I chose to engage in fear and not make that choice. Kind of like that moving to Quebec thing. I felt really angry with myself for not having jumped on that. Although I know that that was, fear did stop me from going to Quebec, But it was one of those branching paths where neither path was better or worse than the other, because they both had certain, the lessons of life will present themselves regardless. I didn't feel like I was making a bad choice. It was just a choice. And so I don't feel like I made the wrong choice. But even so, I still felt angry with myself, because I know that fear had a part in that choice. Now, in this, you know, moving again, that was very clear. It's like, if I make the wrong choice, there was definitely a wrong choice, one that would hold me in a certain level and not let me grow. And that one, to not have made that one, that would have broken me, just knowing that I was a coward and that I wasn't brave enough to engage with these new energies and new possibilities and new lessons. So anyway, I've been very good about that. I made a promise, take on the challenges when you know they're the right ones, and that they're ones that are scripted for you. That's an instinct thing. I just, you know. And so now there's a dog in my life, and she's wonderful. And we have a big space that's like a dog run. There's a big enclosed area that's like an acre or a half acre. It's big enough for a dog to run around and be a dog. And there's three other dogs living on the property with our landlords, and they all play together. And the morning will happen when Moo will wake me up or come, it's time to go and visit the Muppets. We call them the Muppets. They have two Polish water dogs. I don't know if they're Polish or not, but these fluffy, weird creatures that look like Muppets. Andrew, one of my landlords, Andrew and his wife rent the place to us. He was saying, yeah, they look like little men in dog suits. And when he said that, like, you can't unsee it. They're just these fluffy, weird things. Anyway, they're crazy because they were born during COVID and they weren't really socialized with the dogs. So they're just nuts. Moo is a very, very good girl and beautiful, beautiful. I really like her. She's a very pretty husky. And anyway, they all play together. So they'll go out and that's their routine. And we throw frisbees and we run around. That's every day. Less so in the summer now. It's very, very hot out there. And so we have different routines. But that's a big step. There's now animals in my life. And there's chipmunks and squirrels that have made themselves known on the back deck, which is really exciting. And just this morning, I got this one little squirrel whose name is Spaz, because they all have different qualities, and he ate out of my hand. That was really cool. So that's kind of an update on what's been going on. And every step along the way is just like, okay, moving all my crap, getting a truck and getting friends to help and helping them with their stuff, because everyone in my life has also been sort of going up a level. And so there's been so much activity. Right now I'm planning a wedding. Wow, that's a mind breaker. And I just haven't been making videos. I haven't been in the studio. I haven't, although I was exploring some interesting possibilities. I took the whole studio kit and broke it down into a little travel bag. And I was going out to different events and recording those. And I want to do more of that. But things are settling now to a point where it's like, okay, I really want to get back into being creative and not just sort of running pilot light to comic pages. I've been keeping up with the comics. It's been a little bit behind on a couple of months, but I'm feeling like it's now time to jump. And I didn't even know what I was going to talk about today. There's all these things that I have on my mind that I'd love to share, and I want to make a regular sort of put it on as a more regular event, you know. And so today was to set up cameras, resetting up shots and putting the lighting in place and get on with it, you know. I didn't know what I was going to talk about when I sat down, and this is what I ended up talking about. So anyway, that's that. I'm going to call this a video, and I've actually got to go. Creed's found an event for us to go to. There's some fireworks that are going to be happening tonight, so we're going to go out and look at some fireworks. So that'll be cool, and I'll catch up with you again in another video. All right, take care. Love you all. Bye.